meaning that I'm studying a country, a species in a country, and I know that this species is accessible to other places, but my sample is restricted in this country. So shall I restrict my prediction to this country, or I go with them anymore?
Very good question. Hala will give the example of her project, which is detailed sampling across the country total for a species that's distributed essentially across the tropics of the world. So we have a very broad animal that's gotten to every continent, and we have a very restricted sampling because the sorts of sampling that Hala's group did are actually not very common when you go in and take these detailed samples of mosquito populations. So remember what we talked about as far as delimiting your study area. It's the intersection of M and S. And in this case, M is big and the area sampled is quite small. It's a subset of M. So in this case, S drives your analysis area. In another case, maybe you look at GBIF as your sample. So it's global sampling, but maybe your species is endemic to Madagascar. So even though you have a data set that covers the mammals of the world, this particular species you're interested in is endemic to Madagascar, and you have no evidence that it's been optimized. So either M or S or both can participate in shaping your study area. In your case particularly, total is a small subset of the distributional potential of Aedes aegypti, and so the answer is very clear. You limit it to total. You could broaden it if your sampling is broad. Okay? Here's the deal. You have to include within your study area only those areas that could have yielded a positive if the species is there. If you broaden to include Benin and Nigeria and Cameroon, you had no sampling there. So it's impossible for Nigeria to yield a positive because you had no sampling there in your data set. Now, I think I know what you want. You want to know what potential distributional patterns of the species are in Benin, Nigeria, and Cameroon. So what you want to do is calibrate your model within M intersect S, but then project it to your larger area. Okay? So Richard showed you this briefly in that sum, where there's one line for projection. So you could take the MODIS data for total and use that as the calibration area, M intersect S, but then project to the whole area covered by your MODIS levels. Okay? And that will give you a view of how the model that you calibrated based on the new sample, how those model rules apply more broadly. Now, in just a moment, we're going to have a discussion about interpreting XF models, and you're going to be shown a map that's called MESS, Multivariate Environmental Similarity Services. And MESS tells you, there's another paper about to appear that maybe gives a better answer, but MESS tells you how much confidence you should have in these projections. The reason is, imagine we calibrate a model based on total. And you want to know what's the risk of getting bitten by Aedes aegypti in Greenland. Right? Well, the conditions on Greenland do not exist in total. And so it's a horrible extrapolation of your model. Probably your model is meaningless and irrelevant to Greenland. So when we get to something that's outside of the range of the calibration region, we really shouldn't interpret that. endemic species. So remember back to the presentation I gave you on the BAMS analysis. You need to think about why your species is endemic to wherever it's endemic to. And you need to think about a probable BAMS scenario for it. And remember when it's emblematic, when it's a Wallace and Green scenario, you're not going to be able to fit it really well. So that's just a caveat. Okay? That applies to all of the projects. Think about the BAMS scenario in advance. The main question is about one form. So the short answer is no but, which is to say, no, you're not going to fit a great rich one. But there are a lot of things you can do. That one point, we hope, is somewhere within the niche of your species. Right? It tells us something about what your species does for a living. And so I've been involved in a couple projects like this where, no, you're not going to be able to get a serious, robust niche model. But what you can do is use a very simple algorithm. I would look at something like the environmental distance algorithm in open modeling. And what you can do is look for similar environments. You're going to have to do this over a very local scale, right? A local region. You have to use satellite imagery. But what you do is you build essentially a similarity. And so imagine over, you know, 10 square kilometers or 100 square kilometers, you get a map that says, well, the environments here, here, and here, and here are very similar to that one place where your species is at. And those other environments are very different. So I've got a couple of papers I can show you where we did that. We built very simple similarity maps, or we want to call them niche models. We sent field crews out to sample, and indeed they found additional populations. There was a tree in Northeast India that was thought to exist in the form of a single living individual. And they knew exactly where that individual was, so we built these similarity maps, and that led to field crews encountering another 10 or 12 individuals. Okay? So it's not a niche model, it's just, well, where can I find similar circumstances? And you can, in theory, then, if you're lucky and you generate more occurrences by finding more populations in your plant, you can then turn around and build a lesser decision.
I'm not a specimen yet, but they are saying when you are modeling, you are considering something like a solution. Is there anything, any impact in terms of a solution when you are using this model?
The question is about spatial resolution and whether that affects these model outcomes. And the answer is definitely yes, for a bunch of reasons. One is that if you have very coarse resolution, there are geographic features that you cannot see. Okay? Which is to say, if you have very coarse resolution, you may not be able to perceive mountains or mountaintop. It may manifest in reality in different conditions.
Right.
Also, if resolution of your current state is very coarse, at something that's on mountaintops at least around the mountains, because you're not going to learn very much. You need to restrict yourself to fairly broadly manifested phenomena so that you have a chance to see, perceive, and interpret. Okay. One last question, and we'll go on to the next time.
I just want to compliment what you are saying. We talk about spatial resolution, but sometimes, depending on the species, time resolution is also a very important factor. For example, if you are predicting something related to insects and you are using monthly data, you may not get the base result if you use, let us say, annual or daily data. It's recommended to use, for example, daily data at high precision in your result. Because insect development are very, if you are using climate data, for example, they are temperature dependent. And if you are taking average morning or average daily, the result can be totally different. I mean, time resolution, space resolution are important and can really affect.
That's a very good point. For those of you who are studying insects and anything that has a fast population biology or a short lifespan, those considerations are quite critical. And so we have a bunch of people in here interested in medical entomology and pest organisms and things like that. Now, it's probably not feasible to include an environmental layer. But you do need to give yourself a chance to detect and respond to, in these models, the daily phenomena. So it's a frontier. I've got one paper that Enrique and I did where we looked at monthly resolution predictions for dengue vectors in Mexico. That was fairly challenging. Some ideas about how to take it down to the year weekly levels, but it's going to be quite challenging in terms of doing it in this spatially explicit mapping sense. So that's certainly a research frontier as far as